Well, I guess about the only way to get back into it is to get back into it, meaning recording videos for posterity's sake, for God, for people in general, or even maybe those that might have at some point in time benefited from some of the wisdom that I've learned along the way, which I've made. Some of the fallacies that people deal with on a regular basis that maybe I addressed at one time and now you're looking for more information. Well, reflections may not be exactly what you're looking for. Reflections are more kind of a diary journal, at least to start with, and thoughts on humanity and human beings, perspectives on people that are around me, visions of the view that I have about life in general, as well as faith and hope, families, society, politics. You know, that's kind of an interesting thing is that, now that I mention it, you know, the view that I have, the perspective, you know, it's like, well, if you really understand what God is saying, then democracy is not your answer, because there has never been a time in the history of human beings and interactions with God, their creator, that mankind, when he voted, came up with the right conclusion. You see, God's will is not a matter of decision making by people, but rather response to God telling you what to do. Now, you may not like that, and you may call that slavery or autocratic or non-democratic, but that's a fact. The reality is that God intended for man himself to be so interactive with him that by his Spirit, the Spirit of God that could dwell in every man, that man would be able to have an interaction with God vertically and horizontally have interaction with man on a basis that would be communicative, would be cooperative, and would be in communion with God and with man. That's kind of why the summation of the law is boiled down to, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Because the two go hand in hand. You have two hands. One goes up, one goes sideways. I mean, literally. And the fact that God created us to have interaction and intercommunication with himself as well as with each other demonstrates the reality of what we're failing at when it comes to politics and democracy. People don't go into politics because they want to change the world or make it better. They go into it for partially a response to a given situation and circumstance that they want changed, which is selfishness in its ultimate definition. And they cannot trust God to take care of it for them down the road by the changing of circumstances or, as God often does, the changing of our perspective. Because you see, when you trust in the Lord with all your heart, leaning not in your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledging him and he directing your path, you find that life in general changes around you and God changes you accordingly by way of the development of our mental process, emotional stability, soulful experience, and spiritual growth. I mean, we're meant to be a tripartite being, and if you're focused in on simply intellectualism and patriotism and humanism, then you're going to focus only on your flesh. Well, you know, good luck with that. It doesn't take a genius to figure out that politics don't work.
And democracy is falling apart just as fast as, well, every election. You can see that representation was never part of the issue because I'm not represented. I mean, I already know that. I knew that before I ever approached looking at democracy. I studied it. They said, you know,
In Greek, they had one man, one vote. Well, that's democracy. Okay, I get that part. You know, hey, yeah, but what happens when the majority votes against the minority? Well, in America, they had to put safeguards in to protect the minority because the majority would have wiped out the minority. You see, that's kind of what the problem is with voting, with politics, with democracy, with thinking that somehow, some way, the majority of people are going to come up and be really loving and caring and take care of each other. I don't know where you grew up at or where you come from, but not my experience. So when they talk about things like this racial training thing about how, you know, mankind is, you know, America's all bad and Christians are trying to get involved with the Republicans and Republicans are trying to tell people that, well, this race theory, you know, whatever thing, it's, you know, bad because it's making us out to be like, you know, we're all a bunch of racists. We are. Bottom line, I mean, God said we're all sinners. I mean, it doesn't take a genius to figure out that someone that looks different, acts different, and is different sometimes gets picked on more than someone who is the homogeneous looking reflection in the mirror of ourselves. And most people can't live with themselves anyway, so that doesn't work either. So you see, it's really not in politics a mental issue or a legal issue or a voting issue. It's a heart issue. And that's why religion has to be involved, because religion is the external application of what's going on in the internal. And so a lot of times I hear people talk about politics and they're a Republican, they're a Democrat, they're a liberal, they're a conservative. Well, Jesus wasn't any of those. And he was all of those. You see, that's what I find interesting on reflecting back on. Where did you guys come from when you got saved? I mean, sometimes I look at it and I go, did you read what Jesus said? Do you make it up and change it? And bottom line is, yeah, we don't like what he said, so we have to change it to make it fit our version of Jesus, which is why you have different versions of the Bible. You got different versions of Jesus. You got versions of religion. You got versions of politics. I mean, no two people now anymore, in America especially, can agree on even one set of facts. I mean, you know, if it's going to make me look bad, then I'm going to change the facts. You know, it's just not a lie, but it's not the truth either. Or it's not the facts as they occur. You see, truth is not something that people will admit to. Even Jesus in his day had a problem with truth because he said, I'm true. And people will look at him like, huh? What do you mean? Well, I'm the physical representation of God, so I am the embodiment of truth. Look at me and you'll see truth. Nah, I don't think so. And they didn't accept the truth. And I can understand why. They had no basis to relate to the truth. Even the Roman procurator, you know, or the Roman centurion, or the Romans, you know, that was in charge at the time, said, hey, what is truth? I mean, they were very relative about everything. You know, it's like, oh, well, you know, Rome is law, and this is what the law is. We're simple, boom, boom, boom. You know, you commit violence, you kill them. You know, they kind of wiped out, you know, they're like a Cuban kind of thing. They wiped out, you know, crime just easily because they would kill them or slave them, you know. Basically, most of the time, put them in slavery. But the problem being is that as you grow older, you realize and recognize the fallacy or the foolishness of the things that you invest your time in. And you don't want to do them. You don't want to do that anymore. And they can't get out from under once they've stuck themselves into political machinery. Because they have people around them that are pushing them, propping them up, making them feel good, saying, look, we can accomplish this. Such a deal. All you got to do is just tell the people what they want to hear. I just went through 4 years of watching people, you know, put up with somebody who told them what they wanted to hear. And scary thing is by the time he got done, he almost totally destroyed the nation. I mean, it could have been a revolution real easy. It wouldn't have lasted long, the revolution, but it would have been pretty nasty. And I remember the 60s weren't quite so as peaceful, you know. There were a lot of riots going on all over the country at one time because of Nam and other things. Hey, we are not as unified, the United States, as we pretend to be, because we can't admit the truth. So, in reflecting, I guess what I like to do is I like to just think about it for a while, and I kind of go, well, you know.
What is truth? And Jesus said he is, so I have to always take back to my reflections on what I'm looking at when it's like people are bad, you know, some of my neighbors are really a mess, you know. I was like, well, but what is the truth about it? Well, Jesus. Ah, so the guy over there, you know, to my right, doesn't go to church. The guy over there to my left doesn't go to church. The guy behind me doesn't go to church. And the guy to my right doesn't go to church. Well, if they don't even go to church, then God knows they probably don't have a relationship with God. I mean, sure, there are times that I don't go to church because, first of all, I affect people when I go to church. God has a way of doing that, you know, when you basically have the Holy Spirit inside you, you know. You affect people because you stand up for truth. Well, you don't even have to stand up. You just exist. And light brings forth revelation to darkness. And you know, sometimes I'd rather sit at home and let people do their own sin than to watch and see how bad sometimes people make things out to be or do things. And so when I get involved in reflecting, I have to always bring back the reflection of what I am. You see, as a reflection of God, my life is supposed to be reflecting the work God is doing in my life as he is working out his salvation in me, through me, to accomplish his purposes, as well as, hopefully, the salvation of some others. Doesn't mean everyone's going to get saved, because believe me, I know a lot of people that, you know, frankly, I'd like to, but I won't. But, you know, some people that deserve hell, and they don't go there. But in reality is a lot of people do wind up in hell. And that's not acceptable, really. I mean, for anyone. Even though I know someone, Lord, you know, you and me, hey, let's talk. You know, that guy, you know. You know. But no, you know, God saves them, you know. And I mean, even Trump could be saved eventually, you know. Wealthy people typically do not get saved, you know. So usually you can look around and figure that one out. You know, it doesn't take a genius to go, hey, you know, these guys are doing great humanitarian aid work. And then suddenly you look at their lifestyle. Whoa, wait a minute. You got divorced how many times? You got this how many times? Your children are doing what? And they're doing this and you're doing that. And you got this and you got that. Oh, well, I'm glad at the end of your life you think that, you know, you can rack up points with God. Which you can rack up points with God, but if you don't have God in you, with you, through you, for you, you think God's going to take you someplace? He will, but not where you think you're going. So, reflecting, you know, if I, like David, sat back and said, oh, it seems like the world is going to hell, you know, and everybody's getting away with murder, you know, they're getting away with money, and they're getting away with this, that, and the other thing. But then you sit back and you kind of go, but, you know, when they die, they go to hell. That kind of bums me out then, you know, that's kind of a bummer then. So, I don't know where we're going to go with these reflections, you know, I don't know how long this is, almost 15 minutes, so, you know, let me put my glasses on so I could see, you know, they look better without camera, you know. Oh, there we go. 14 minutes, 30 seconds. So I got 30 seconds to wrap this up. So reflecting on life in general, I guess, and reflections of what we should be, which is a reflection of God himself, then I have to look at what am I a reflection of? Am I a reflection of only myself in the mirror? Are you?
Or are you becoming a reflection of God Almighty, that He created you to be a reflection of His Son?